Remember the 2000s? LL Cool J wouldn't be caught dead not in Fubu, and even crashed the Gap commercial wearing a Fubu hat. Jay-Z and everybody signed to The Rock repped hard for Rockaware, and everybody from Usher to Beyoncé could be seen in Sean John. Kids these days may not realize, but there was a time where rappers having a clothing line was a prerequisite. Or if they didn't have one of their own, they had to be closely affiliated with one. Today, rappers brag about high fashion brands like Gucci and Louie, but in the 2000s, the upstart urban brands were the du jour in the rap game. I'm Nate the Great from Take Flight 214, and we've done videos on the history of hip-hop fashion. And in that video, which you can find in the link above, we discuss the evolution of hip-hop fashion from the start till today. We went through the history of how fashion changed through the years, but in this video, we hyper-focus on the early 2000s, which was a boom for burgeoning brands, and those headed by rappers were the biggest among all. But before we get started, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button. We're about a little less than 100 subs away from being able to monetize here on YouTube, and as I always say, if we can start getting paid for doing these, then we can hire more people so that we can improve on the quality and the frequency in which we release these. So if you like videos like these and you want us to do more, then liking and subscribing to the channel will help us spread the reach and continue to grow more. So with that being said, let's jump right in. One of the first rap-related brands to release and blow up, and the name explains it all for this one, For Us, By Us. Fubu was the brainchild of Damon John, a kid from Queens, New York, with his sights set on hitting it big in the urban apparel market. His first taste of success came in 1989 after making $800 in one day on a batch of wool hats he had a friend sew up for him. John noticed the cultural relevance of screen printed t-shirts, and shortly thereafter whipped up a few in response of the Rodney King riots and the arrest of Mike Tyson for rape in 1992. In an interview with the Washington Post, John admitted that the shirts set off a light bulb in his young entrepreneurial driven mind. Quote, "It showed me something about the reason people buy clothes. That when there's an emotional connection, products sell quicker. That's when I started thinking about the concept of For Us, By Us." To expand the line's reach, the designer teamed up with three of his childhood friends from Queens. They moved the operation to John's mother's house and took a second mortgage on the home to turn it into a makeshift factory, sewing labels onto his signature baseball caps and football jerseys. Their first celebrity endorser turned devoted Fubu ambassador was rapper LL Cool J in 1993. And as I said before, he repped so hard that he famously once wore a Fubu hat, pirate style, in a commercial that he had been paid to do for Gap. Fubu took off after that. By 1997, the line was raking in nearly $40 million. By 1998, over $350 million. John acquired a handful of brands including Coogee, Drunk Monkey, and Heatherette. All but Coogee have since failed. He would relaunch Fubu as FB Legacy in 2010, using rappers like Soulja Boy, Roscoe Dash, and Slim Thug to attract customers. Fat Form is another OG brand born in hip-hop. The company's founder, Russell Simmons, also happens to be the brother of Run DMC's frontman and early reality TV star Reverend Run. Before Simmons founded Fat Form in 1992, his primary focus was on music. With his partner Rick Rubin, he launched Def Jam Records, just 8 years before signing major rap acts like the Beastie Boys, Public Enemy, and of course, Run DMC. Russ Communications was soon created thereafter and housed Fat Form, a clothing line Simmons sold in a small shop in the New York Soho district. While Simmons does admit that Fat Form was not an immediate success, losing him almost $10 million during the first 6 years, he said that once things took off, they really took off and boosted his net worth to nearly $300 million. Although inexperienced, his designers were spot on with their collections, creating hoodies and t-shirts with the brand's signature P logo. At one point, it's being carried in over 3,000 US retail stores, including Macy's, Bloomingdale's, and others. However, in a 2003 interview with Bloomingdale Business, Russell Simmons stated that he grew frustrated with being stymied into the ethnic brand category. The label, along with Kimora Lee Simmons' line Baby Fat, failed in part thanks to oversaturation in the hip-hop clothing market, as there is definitely a gift and a curse to widespread distribution. Simmons sold Fat Form and Baby Fat to Kellwood Company in 2004. for $140 million. Today, Fat Form shoes are perpetually remaining on the clearance racks in places like Sears and even Kmart. I mean, wow, Russell really got out of that one at the right time. In 1999, Jay-Z was the biggest rapper in the game. He was on top of his craft and in a time where physical albums sold more than any other moment in history, i.e., he was definitely eating from rap music. He introduced the clothing line Rockaware alongside his friends and Rockefeller Records co-founder Dame Dash. The brand offered a wide range of clothing for men, women, and children, including the signature baggy jeans, track jacket, and fur-lined puffer coats. At its peak, Rockaware sales reached $700 million. Everyone from Fat Joe to Kanye West and Trina to Victoria Beckham attended the label's parties and fashion shows decked out in apparel. Rockaware was poetically name-dropped in a handful of Jay-Z's songs, including Guns N' Roses with Lenny Kravitz and Take You Home With Me featuring R. Kelly. But after his business relationship with Dame Dash began to sour in 2006, so did the popularity of the clothing line. The rapper sold the clothing line to Iconics Group in 2007 for $204 million in cash. So, I don't know exactly what they mean when they say in cash. I mean, do like the Iconics guys roll up with Chris Beals in a duffel bag like an old school drug deal or what? I mean, I'm not sure what they mean, but maybe they just mean they had all the money up front and didn't have to raise any funds. But anyway, rumors of the brand's demise were shrugged off by Jay-Z and Iconic Group in 2012, but sales would dip to $500 million. Jay-Z hadn't abandoned the clothing line altogether, having stayed on as the head product development and marketing and licensing since selling the company, but he has stopped promoting it in his music. He no longer rocks Rockaware anymore either. It's all about Tom Ford now, apparently, I guess. Vocal was launched in 1997 by Yomi Martin, his cousin Carnell Nelly Hayes, and Nick Lofton. They wanted to launch a new brand which was not driven by big marketing budgets and didn't have the standard logos and designs. Yomi and Nelly were looking for a new innovative brand with daring and the unique designs where the clothes speak for themselves. While Yomi focused on the clothing line, Nelly focused on the music career. With the Say Lunatic's popularity growing, Vocal even began touring with the group, representing Vocal and selling clothes after the St. Lunatic's events. Many people wanted to be seen wearing what the then independent artists were seen in. When Nelly's debut album Country Grammar released in 2000 and spent 7 weeks atop the U.S. album charts and went 9 times platinum, fueled by the enormous success of his title track. And with that debut, Vocal was instantly known all over the country. Vocal essentially grew right along with the career of Nelly and the St. Lunatics, and then it crashed with it as well. But Nelly actually had a long and lucrative music career, and he also launched the popular women's jeans line by the name of Apple Bottom, which, although very popular at the time, would eventually lose steam as well. Puffy is known for his many entrepreneurial investments and undertakings. Alongside his scouting, starting, and ripping off the careers of several young artists with his label Bad Boy Records, he also tried his hand in the fashion game with his brand Sean John in 1998. And in fact, Diddy's clothing line of luxury denims and furs were probably taken more serious than most other clothing lines at the time. He utilized his fellow musicians in his advertisements, like Usher, Mariah Carey, and Busta Rhymes. His men's and women's fashion shows were even listed on the New York Fashion Week schedule, with a front row that consisted of high profile at the time celebrities like Paris Hilton and industry top dogs like Anna Wintour. Channing Tatum and Tyson Beckford would launch their careers as models through the brand as well. Sean John incurred slight losses throughout 2008 and 2010, when sales dropped from $350 million from $525 million previously. He also closed his line's Fifth Avenue flagship store in New York in 2010. Yet despite all of Sean John's success, it still fell off. Over the years, there were even more rapper-related brands than we have listed here. There was actually quite a few more. LL Cool J, after getting his beak wet with Fubu, would later launch Todd Smith, which bore a striking resemblance to Ed Hardy, Affliction, or Jim Jones's Gnostic. But hey, that was the look at the time, and LL thought it would work, but it didn't, at least not for long. Lil Bow Wow even had a brand named Shago, which I didn't even know about, so that lets you know how trashly obscure that must have been. Master P had his P. Miller and Shaq had his Twism brand. And yes, yes, you can consider Shaq a rapper. I mean, hey, when I was 11, I thought his tracks were pretty dope, but don't blame me. Again, I was 11. Snoop Dogg tried Rich and Famous, and Tiger's Last Kings actually slapped for a while, till it didn't. Busta Rhymes, during his weird spastic phase, had Bushy Sports, which was basically looks from his closet. Outkast had Outkast Clothing Company for a while. And I mean, I literally do not remember ever seeing this stuff being sold anywhere other than Ross or Burlington Coat Factory at markdown prices. Eminem had Shady LTD, which opened the door for 50 Cent's G-Unit clothing, neither of which I was really ever a fan of, but hey, to each his own. Hey, remember FJ560? Yeah, me either. Fat Joe tried to get it going for about a year before giving up on it. And this list is getting a little too long, so here's a few more that we didn't mention. It's kind of like honorable mentions, and also for the sake of speeding it up a little bit. Do you notice a pattern here? Many of the brands that we talked about today were wildly popular at the time, but all fell from grace for their own unique reasons. Most of the brands were solely popularized by the rapper associated with them. Some of them obviously look better than others, but they all fell off around and about the same time their respective rappers did. And say what you will about these brands, but what they did do was help open the door for urban style. Streetwear, from a small business perspective, was nowhere near as big in the 90s as it became in the latter 2000s, and tons of credit has to go to this whole rapper wanna clothing line phase. From 2000 to about 2015 or so, small startup brands were everywhere. The barrier to entry was a lot more surmountable thanks to the internet, and though that could be good and bad, it changed the fashion game as a whole. Graphic tees and denim that many of these brands popularized show upscale creatives that it was possible for them to get their visions out too. And granted, by the end of the run, it had gotten a bit oversaturated, but all in all, it was a beautiful thing. And I, for one, I really miss it. Today, rap has pivoted again back to the high fashion houses of Paris and Milan. And rather than creating their own lines and visions, they praise luxury brands as the pinnacle of success. The problem with this is multifaceted. One, these brands have never cared about the urban market. They besmirched it in the past and they pander to it now. But make no mistake about it, they don't give two F's. Two, it hurts the outlook of small startup brands. If the aspiration is to own Gucci or Louie, then that leaves little room for small brands because the look is completely different. Even though most of the high fashion brands started out ripping off looks from smaller streetwear companies, rap fans will rather the prestige of having Gucci on their shirt. Which brings us to three. Many of rap's fans cannot afford these brands. Yet they strive to spend money that they should not be spending on exorbitantly expensive pieces. And no, some of the rapper branded stuff wasn't from the 2000s wasn't super cheap either, but they were nowhere nearly as outrageously expensive as the high fashion stuff. But anyway, you know what I mean? Don't get me ranting. Let's close this up. So how many of these brands do you remember? Did you own any of these? Let us know in the comment section. Also, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe button because, again, we're about 100 subs away from being able to monetize, and we can't get there without you guys' help. Also, we've done a few more videos on hip-hop fashion history and sneaker history, so if you enjoyed this video, then you might want to go back and check those out. So, for TakeFlight214.com, I am Nate the Great, signing out until next time. Peace.